Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How are you?
Blessed and highly favored.
Are you alive, alert, awake, and enthusiastic?
Yes.
Did you come here to hear the message that Jesus has for you?
Amen.
Amen. I came here for that. I came here expecting. I've been waiting all week for this day, this time, at this hour. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's bow our heads and pray this morning and open up. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the smiles upon our face, the life that you've given us, the life that you've given us inside of each and every one of us to be able to make it bright and shine and share it with someone who maybe just doesn't know you, Lord. Lord, let our Jesus in our hearts shine from our hearts so brightly that there's no mistaking that you are one of Jesus' soldiers. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful place that you've given us to raise your name upon high and to leave all of our concerns here at your feet, Jesus. And Jesus, as you continue to love each and every one of my brothers, each and every one of the days that you give us, Lord, we can only thank you and repay you each and every day. And in Jesus' precious name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Let's stand and sing this morning.
Page 404 in the hymnal. It's a good song for this morning. I notice it's snowing a little bit outside.
Walking in sunlight, all of my journey.
Take the name of Jesus.
I didn't even eat no candy, Amy.
Ooh, that's one more. Okay, everybody sing loud.
I know.
Well, would you look at that? How many names popped out of that little container this last week, huh? There was three of them. You see your name up there, Jerry? It has been written. Huh? Dennis, Jerry, and Sherry. Look at there. You've been chosen. What do you make of that? Good. You've been feeling the prayers? We're sending them your way. Somebody must be doing something, huh? Good. I want you to feel them. I really do. I want all of you guys to feel the prayers from each other, one to another, one for all and all for one, right? All for one being Jesus. Amen? Amen. Anybody with a testimony they want to share with us? Anybody at all this week? Any testimonies at all? Nobody has a testimony? We woke up this morning. Amen? That's a testimony. You got a testimony?
I just thank the Lord that He's got me through these last 2 weeks from both deaths of my friends. And He's been there with me. I could feel Him all the way.
Amen. Amen. Your heart might be sad. But you've got to be glad for where you know she's at. And she beat us there. Which is okay. Just means that she's paving the way for us, which is okay. Jesus paved the way for us. We just got to follow Him. Amen? Amen. Amen. Have you been encouraging people to read the Bible? Ooh, there's a new one. Did you have a testimony, Jerry?
Yeah.
What do you got to say, young lady? We should give the glory to God for everything that does come into our life and those things that He keeps out of our life. That's a big thing too, right? Aren't you glad that God keeps you on a righteous path? Amen. All testimonies. Those are all opportunities to give a testimony. And think about this. I want you to understand this, that what you give, you get. What you give, you get. So if you're going to share your testimony with somebody, they're going to share theirs with you. And some of the stories on how people have found Jesus are simply amazing. Isn't it amazing how you found Jesus? Or He found you? It's simply just amazing. And I think all in itself, that is a book all in itself, on how your testimony for each and every one of you, how you came to Jesus, or how Jesus came to you. Imagine writing that book. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's put our hands together this morning for our pastors.
Amen. Good to be here this morning. Good to see you that's here. We're still low in number, but we're praying that God will restore us back where we were at. And more, and He will. All we have to do is just trust Him. One verse of Scripture this morning. I want to read to you. It's in Psalms chapter 87, verse 6. Pray that God will have His way in the message. Today I'm excited about the message. Hopefully it comes out the way the Lord has given it to me. Thank you for your prayers this past week for the funeral, Sister Shoba, her home going. We're thankful that the Lord worked it all out. I prayed all day, pretty much all week up until then, that I could contain my cough. And I don't think I coughed but one time, maybe, during the whole funeral service. So that was a blessing to me. small steps, I guess you'd say. Trying to maintain this cord here. I had some technical difficulties last Sunday. I stuck this in my pocket and I turned it off. So I started out listening to the service, editing the service last Sunday for our YouTube, and it's all going well. Songs lead into the message, and as I told him Thursday night, I don't usually listen to the message because I don't really like your pastor. But I went to the end. I always listened to the first little bit and then the end. And when I got moved down to the end, there was no sound. I was just... And I thought, well, something happened. So I backed up and I realized that I had turned the microphone off when I stuck it in my pocket. So hopefully that'll be a problem remedy this week with our PA system getting straightened out. And that's part of the TVs getting put up on the wall, the monitors, as also the PA system, and have a different microphone than this one. So hopefully God works all that out for us. All right, got a strange scripture to read. One that you probably have never read. Or if you have, you didn't pay attention. Psalms 87, verse 6. It says, "The Lord shall count when he writeth up the people, that this man was born there, Selah." Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for looking down upon us and, Lord, giving us the opportunity to be in your house. Lord, you're such a gracious and merciful God. And, Lord, I thank you today that you've allowed each one of us to be here, Lord, and made arrangements for us to come. Lord, you've allowed us to be able to sing and pray and fellowship together. And now, Lord, as we go into the Word, pray that you'd give what's needful, Lord, for all of us that's present this morning. Help us to be encouraged today. Help us to rejoice for the things that you've given to us. Lord, help us to praise you even when it seems like there's no reason to praise. Help us, Lord, to praise you. And Lord, help us not to forget that when things are good, Lord, to praise you. Look down on all that's our duty to pray for today. Give life to them, Lord, and life more abundant. And Lord, just thank you for all that you do. Bless your servant as I stand here. Give me the words that's necessary for this congregation that I might say something, Lord, to help us to take another step toward home. And Lord, don't let me get in your way today, but you deliver the message and the power and the demonstration of your Spirit. And Lord, in all things, I'll praise you and glorify your name. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. And amen. Amen. Read the verse if you keep your Bible open. If you brought your Bible and read along there, that verse again says, "The Lord shall count when he writeth up the people, that this man was born there." And then that word that we find in the book of Psalms, Selah, S-E-L-A-H, which many different ideas on what that word means. Potentially means as they were singing. You know, these psalms are considered as songs. Brother Dutch used to say, "I wish I knew the tune to some of these songs that's in the Bible." As they sang, that word at the end, that Selah, some believe meant to sing louder or sing silenter or quieter or to stop altogether. But that's not the message. It's added peace this morning. My thought is counting on the Lord to count me. Counting on the Lord to count me. Not counting on the Lord to count on me, because that would be a big failure on God's part. But counting on the Lord to count me. Now the scripture said, "The Lord shall count when he writeth up the people." You know, the Bible and us, it's been here that on Thursday nights, know for the last year and a half, 2 years, the Bible is a numbers book. We're in Numbers. We're Numbers 19 is what we passed through this past week. So we've gone 19 chapters into Numbers, but we were into Numbers long before we got into the actual book. The Bible gives us reference to many places where the Lord kept count. Genesis chapter 4 talks about Adam and Eve and their offspring. the sons of Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, and their offspring. Genesis 5 gives us 1,650 years worth of names and numbers of people who were born, their children, and how old they were when they died. Genesis 6 gives us the story of Noah and talks about the 8 souls that got on board the ark. We go where we're at now in the book of Numbers. It gives us 600 and I believe it was 35,000 footmen, men who were able to go to war and fight for the cause of the Israelite people. Just warriors. That didn't include children and old people or the women. So the numbers would have been incredible. Genesis 46 talks about Jacob when he went into the land of Egypt. You know, Joseph had gone down there and the Lord had blessed him with the ability to provide corn, nourishment to his own family, and he compelled them to come down to Egypt to live. And the Bible says there was 70 that went down into Egypt from the family of Israel, or Jacob as we know it. And then we get into the book of Matthew, chapter number 1. It gives us an account of the lives of Abraham, all his descendants, all the way up to our Savior, Jesus Christ, who was born through Mary, and all the different descendants there. The whole Bible is full of numbers and counts of people. And I think I can say, as we believe that God is the one who inspired men to write the words, so we have to believe that all these numbers that the Bible gives us was inspired by God, that God is a record keeper. The Bible does say, and I preached from it back a year ago or so, where it says that the time would come when the Lord would make up His jewels, and it says that He would open up the record book and find those that had taught His name and who had worked and lived for Him, and said that they would He would make up His jewels. All of that this morning, knowing that according to this scripture, David was looking for a day when the Lord would take a final count. He said, "The Lord shall count when He writeth up the people that that man was born there." Revelation says that there'll come a day when the books will be open. It says that all men will be judged out of those books. And it says that, that there would be a book of life that would be open. And it goes on to tell us that anyone's name who's not found in the book of life would be rejected for eternity. My prayer is this morning that my Lord will count me in that book. That's my prayer. So let's talk about a little bit about what David was hoping for in this scripture. He said, "The Lord shall count when He writeth up the people that this man was born there." What's it talking about? What is this writing? What is the writing all about? What will all of this entail? What will be inside of this writing? Well, inside this writing, there'll be personal matters. I want you to notice in that verse that I gave you this morning to read, or that we read as our text, it says, "When He writeth of the people that this man was born there." Not men, not in plural, but singular it's used. And this morning I want you to know that this is a personal matter that's taken up with God Himself. It's a personal relationship that we have with the Lord.
It's something that's not given by your nationality or by your descendant or by the fact that you knew somebody or the fact that, as we talked a little bit on Thursday night, that you're riding in on somebody else's coattails. But this is a personal matter between you and God. He said, for in that day it would be wrote up that this man was born there. A personal matter that someone has taken account of themselves and realized that they needed to know God, and they took time out to call on God for themselves. Not that I would ever teach to anybody or try to proclaim to anybody. I mentioned last week a little bit about marking people and marking those in your life that have had an influence on you. Anyone that's had an influence on you will not get you into heaven. It'll be a personal matter that's taken up between you and God. Just like the record that's kept here in this world today. I've said before, the world as we know it keeps a record of us. There's a personal record of you signed up wherever that you were born, wherever you were married, in whatever county that you die in. There'll be a personal record kept in everything. You can go on the internet today and find many of these records that have been made, personal accounts of your life. You can go on the internet. Men think they figured something out today, but God knows how to do this a long time. God had this figured out a long time before we did. We think we're smart and knowledgeable. Brother, God figured out how to keep tabs on us a long time ago. Brother, we just need to trust in Him. You can go online today and you can type somebody's phone number in and it'll give you their name, and sometimes it'll give you what city they live in, and sometimes it'll tell you the age range that they are. Or you can type somebody's name in and you can find where they live. Personal things that this world knows. But brother, I'm glad that there's a count being taken today of God's people, and man doesn't know who it is, but God knows who it is, and I'm on the record today as having accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, and I know Him, a personal relationship with God. He took me as one of His own, and I took Him as my Savior. Brother, heaven is my home. It's a personal thing between me and God. He knows me better than I know myself. I can call on Him when I need help. He knows when I do things I shouldn't do. He knows when I need some encouragement. He knows when I need a little bump along this way to keep me going. I have a personal matter that's taken place between me and God. Just like the scripture says, that it be recorded that this man was born there. It covers vital matters, this writing. Vital matters. We all here have a birth certificate. Anybody have a record of your a copy of your birth certificate? There's some vital things put down there. Vital recordings that's put there. It tells who, what your name is, first of all. What you were named as. And the date of your birth. And it records in there the your father and your mother. It records where it happened. It records in a lot of cases who the doctor was that brought you into this world. Notice what it says in this verse again. The Lord shall count when He writeth up the people that this man was born there. There's a vital matter that this writing will have in it. You see, all of us that's been saved by God's grace, it's been born again, we have a record in heaven.
Amen.
And it tells who our Father is.
Amen.
Brother, our Heavenly Father, who sent His only Son into this world to die on the cross, and it tells who our mother is. And I'm not talking about Mary. See, I have problems with people who have so much confidence in the Mother Mary because of her virginity and her purity. Brother, she gave birth to the Son of God through the seed of the Holy Spirit. But that was the end of her purpose as far as her salvation was concerned. If Mary makes it to heaven, she'll make it there the same way I get there. It's through the blood of her Son who died on the cross. Our Mother today is the church, not this building, not this sanctuary that we come and attend, but our Mother is the church, brother, the one that raptured us out of the darkness of this world, pulled us into to her fold. You see, that's why we have such an attachment to church, as it were, because it's our Mother. We're drawn to it. We're compelled to come to our Mother. What does a mother do? The mother nourishes, the mother nurses, the mother teaches, the mother helps the child along the way. Isn't that exactly what the church does for God's people? Brother, we have a Father, we have a Mother, we have a place of birth. Jesus told Nicodemus, Nicodemus said, Rabbi, he said, what is it that I have to do to know about this salvation that you teach? He said, you must be born again. There had to be a birth take place. And let me tell you, if you've been saved by God's grace, there's a birth date on the roll in heaven on your birth certificate there that tells the day that you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior. When the blood of Jesus Christ rolled down from the mercy seat of God and flooded your sinful heart and purged you of your sins, and you were brought out of your dead condition and born into a new life, and you became a new creature. There's vital matters in this record. Your Father, your Mother, the date of your birth, and your name. Your name. John said that when he talked about the Lord and about the Lord's knowledge of us, he said that the Lord would give us a stone, a white stone, and upon that stone a name would be written, that no one would know except him that receiveth and him that giveth. Brother, my name is written in heaven.
Amen.
It's a vital matter. It's important. That's what this writing will contain. Personal matters. Vital matters. Decisive matters. Brother, things that are critical. Important. You see, if there is no record of your birth, you don't exist. You say, well, my heart's still beating. I'm still breathing. But the Bible says, without the Lord, we're dead in our trespasses and sins. And unless we come out of that death into life, there is no record in heaven. There's no record. And when the day comes, as we talked a little bit about Thursday night and preached at the Sister Shelba's funeral this week, when the day comes that the Lord calls us out of this life, when the Lord calls, as Job says, and we answer, if we're not ready, that decision that we made is an eternal decision. You see, we think decisions that we make are important. What we're going to eat for lunch. What we're going to do tomorrow. What we're going to do next week. What clothes we're going to wear. It's important. I figured out today. Joe and Sherry. Last Sunday, Sister Sherry was here 15 minutes before Sunday school. Joe wasn't here. This Sunday, they didn't even make it to Sunday school. So that tells me that Joe spends a whole lot of time making himself look good to come to church. He has a lot of decisions, a lot of decisive matters He spent all morning trying to figure out what he's going to look like to present. And look what we got. It looks just the same this week as it did last week. These decisions we make seem so important. But the greatest decision we can make is whether we're willing to accept Jesus Christ as our Savior or not. Brother, just to think about this. We talked about it in our Sunday school this morning. God has to draw us, right? That's what we learned, is we're dead in trespasses and sins. And something that's dead can't do anything for itself, so it has to be dependent on somebody else to do it for them. The only way we can be saved is if God reaches to us. If God's the one that pulls us out. And God is reaching the people by multitudes. The Bible says multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. There are multitudes that God are reaching to today, and they're not lifting their hand up to be pulled out. They're not willing to accept the Lord. This is a vital, decisive, critical matter that David talked about. So let's talk about who won't be in this writing. Who won't be? The Lord shall count when He writeth up the people that this man was born there. Who won't be? The hearer won't be. We've got a lot of hearers. The Bible talks about hearers. But it said that it's important that you not only be a hearer, but a doer. Well, there'll be a whole lot of hearers who have rejected God and never accepted Him as their Savior, who will eternally be sent to a place that we call hell. And the Bible says where the worm dieth not, where the smoke ascends forever, the fire never goes out, eternal damnation. And people will go there because they were only hearers of the Word. Brother, people who have heard the Word of God, who will stand before God on that day when the books are open. And let me say this, somebody who doesn't know the Lord, that will be the only reference that they have to any possible opportunity to get into heaven is the judging of their works. The judging of their works. Whether that they've worked, done enough in God's eyes, whether they've been righteous enough to make it into heaven, those books will be open. That's the only thing they have to stand on. If they don't know the Lord as their Savior, the only thing they have to stand on is whether they're good enough or not to make it into heaven. And I can tell you right now, the Bible says there's none that's good, no, not one. The Bible says our righteousness is as filthy rags. There'll not be enough good works for a man to get into heaven. People who have heard the Word of God, who have listened to the message, and I think of the hundreds of people that I've preached to over the years who didn't know the Lord as their Savior, and the message was preached, and they got up and walked out of the house of God, and if they would have left for eternity on that very day, they would have had no excuse because they heard the Word and they rejected it. And what a sad condition to be in, that someone would stand before God, knowing that they had opportunity, but turned it away. The hearer won't be there. The hypocrite won't be there. The hypocrite won't be there. What's a hypocrite? It's not by men's definition today. By men's definition, probably all of us here are hypocrites. Because we don't live a Christian life like they think we should. So they'll label us as hypocrites. But a hypocrite is someone who pretends to be something that they're not. Brother, I'm not pretending. I don't know about you, but I'm not pretending to be something I'm not. I'm a sinner that's been saved by God's grace. Brother, I do things I shouldn't do. I say things I shouldn't say. I think things I shouldn't. I don't do what I should do all the time. I don't always do what God wants me to do. So as far as that's concerned, I fit the bill this morning. But I'm talking about somebody who's carrying the cross of Christ as their label, but not living for Him. Somebody who goes to church every Sunday and acts like they know God. Maybe they hold a seat in the church, an office in the church. Maybe they stand behind the podium. And let me say, the Bible tells us plainly that there'll be many who stand before God and say, I've cast devils out in your name. I've proclaimed your name. I've done this for you. I've done that for you. And He'll say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew you. That brings it into perspective. Brother, we need to make sure we've been born there. We need to make sure that our record is in heaven. The hesitant won't be there. The greatest lie the devil ever told is wait. Wait. To that lost soul that's being compelled by the Spirit of God to accept the Lord and turns him away, the devil says, wait. You can wait till next week. You can wait till next Sunday. You're still young. You still got time. You still got years ahead of you. Just wait a little while. To the Christian, the servant of God, who the Lord has called to do something, and they're hesitant about serving Him, the devil will say, wait. Wait till God gives you a better answer. That one stings. Brother, waiting for God to give us a better answer. The greatest lie the devil ever made was wait. Telling people to wait. There's people who woke up this morning with intentions on going to church, but they didn't want to get out of bed. And the devil said, wait till next Sunday. Brother, he's got his devices. Brother, the hesitant won't make it into heaven. Those that have been called by the Lord and turned him away because they've got time. Who will be there? Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Too easy. Brother Kevin, it's too easy. It's too easy. Brother, I took the easy road. I'm glad this morning I took the easy road. Brother, I'm not trying to fall under some church's doctrine. I'm not trying to fall under some preacher's teaching. I'm not trying to fall under some work that that somebody told me I need to do. But I just took the easy road. And I said, yes, Lord, I'll accept you as my Savior. I believe that you're the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross. I believe you laid in the grave. I believe on the third morning you came out. And I believe that one of these days, if I trust in your name, you'll take me to heaven.
Amen.
I took the easy road. Brother, I'm one of the laziest people you'll ever meet in your life. I'm a preacher. That's what we are. I'll take the easy road. I'll take the Lord and what He said. Say, well, you got to be baptized. Well, the thief on the cross wasn't. I was baptized, but didn't have to be. Well, if you don't take communion every Sunday, well, that leaves me out. But let me tell you about the communion I'm taking between me and the Lord. It's a daily ritual.
That's right.
Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, who will be there? Those will be there. That poor soul who never had a thing in their life, who didn't own anything in this world, barely scraped through life, getting a little bit of food to sustain themselves, but they had their hope and trust in the Lord, they'll be there.
Amen.
Brother, that weak soul who barely made it through, but it seems like every time you hear them, they're down and out, they're struggling. It doesn't seem like they can make another step along this way. They're just weak and lowly in life. But they called on the Lord one day and their Christianity hasn't matured like it should. But brother, let me tell you, they accepted the Lord as their Savior, and that's all that matters. Amen. And the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Don't you tell me I'm not a Christian. Brother, I know the price Jesus paid for me.
That's right.
Brother, I know the price He paid for me. I know what He's able to do. I know that He can save sinners. I know that He saved me. Don't you tell me that I'm not a Christian. My name's in glory.
Amen.
What's the writing going to be? It's going to be personal. It's going to be vital. It's going to be decisive. Who won't be there? The hesitant, the hypocrite, the hearer. Who will be there? Whosoever calleth upon the name of the Lord. And then who's doing the counting? Who's doing the counting? See, this is where so many people fail. If you don't fall under some category, then you won't make it. So man says. There's denominations. And I'm not talking about people who are necessarily contrary to God. I'm talking about Christian religions who've got it all mixed up. They think that their doctrine or their beliefs is what makes a difference in the relationship between a person and God. But they're not doing the counting, you see. They're not doing the counting. The social brethren aren't doing the counting. The Baptists aren't doing the counting. The Methodists aren't doing the counting. The Pentecostals aren't doing the counting. The Lord is doing the counting.
Amen.
You say, well, why would the Lord be put into that position? Who else would you want to do it? Brother, who else would you want to do it? Brother, I don't want you recording my life.
That's right.
I don't want you making a decision of whether I'm going to make it to heaven or not. I want a righteous God to make that decision. Brother, I want a merciful God to make that decision. I want a gracious God to make that decision. I want my God to make that decision. And David said, the Lord shall count. This is the same David who said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I want the Lord doing the counting because I can think of nobody else who's more capable or who I would rather do it for me. For He is the righteous one. You know, they have census today. You all know. They send out now. They used to be people. They may still go around, knock on doors and write down how many's in your house and keeping track. Usually the one who would fill out the paper or answer the questions would be the head of the house. The Lord's the head of the house. Brother, I want Him standing at the door proclaiming who is one of His and who's not. See, people say, when I get to heaven, I want to be looking for you. Brother, the first person I'm going to look for when I get to the gates is Jesus.
Amen.
You say, oh, you want to praise Him for eternity. Yeah, but first of all, I want Him to get me in the doors.
Right.
I'm not going to count on you to get me in the pearly gates. People say, make all the jokes about St. Peter when he get to the pearly gates. St. Peter's not going to be standing at the pearly gates. If he gets in, he'll get in the same way I get in, and that's through the precious blood of Jesus.
Right.
When I get to heaven, I'm going to be looking for Jesus Himself because He's the one that's going to stand in front of me and say, here's the record, here's His name, let Him in.
Praise the Lord.
I'm counting on the Lord to count me.
Amen.
The keeper of the jewels. The keeper of the jewels. I thank God this morning that I know the keeper of the jewels. I'm one of His. I'm precious to the Lord. He knows me and I know Him. Malachi chapter 3. If you have your Bibles and read just this and I'll close. Scripture I preached from a while back. Malachi, last book of the Old Testament. Chapter 3, verse 16. It says, then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before Him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon His name. And then in verse 17, it says, and they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. The Lord is keeping a record this morning. The book's open and He's writing names in. There's somebody today. I know. I just know it. I just know it. There's somebody today somewhere who heard the voice of the Lord and they hearkened to Him and they humbled their heart. And they said, Lord, I accept You as my Savior. And immediately, their name was written in the book. I just know it. I just know that there's still people who are willing to lay aside the ways of this world and let the Lord write their name in His book. I believe the Lord has intentions. If we see it tomorrow, the Lord believes that there's somebody who will hearken to His name so He can write him in the book. There's somebody we know, somebody we work with, somebody we're related to, who needs to have their name written in the book. You say, well, how do you make it happen? I can't make it happen, but I can lead them in the right direction. And if you've been saved by God's grace, you can do the same thing. The day when the Lord writes up His people, that they were born there. My prayer is this morning that you were born there. That new life came, that darkness was removed, that the shadow and oppression of this life was taken away, and a new vision came through the Lord Jesus Christ. Because I'm counting on the Lord to count me. Stand with me this morning, will you? Just want to sing this last verse again. Actually, the first verse of this song that we sang earlier. My name is in the book of life. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. I rise above all doubt and strife and read my title clear. I know my name is there. I know my name is written there. I know my name is there. I know my name is written there. Dear Lord, thank you this morning for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. Lord, thank you for your book, Lord, and thank you that you took time to reach down to me, Lord, a lost sinner that with no hope, Lord, dead to your world and dead to the spiritual things. But Lord, you gave me life. Lord, you took away the darkness. Lord, you took away death. You took away eternal damnation. And Lord, you gave me hope and you gave me life. Lord, eternal life. Look down on us today, Lord, and help us to carry the message with us. Help us, Lord, to tell others about how great that you are. Lord, bless us with the things that we need to make it through this life. Lord, until that day you call us home. And then, Lord, as we come looking for you on that glorious day, Lord, receive us into your holy kingdom. Bless all it's our duty to pray for. Keep us safe as we travel away from the sanctuary. Bring us back the next appointed time. In Jesus' name I pray. And amen. Good day. God bless you.
Mountain.